Please take your seat. Our program is about to begin.
Thanks especially to those of you who traveled to our event. Today is a very, very special day for us. We are incredibly excited to talk to you about what we view as the next horizon in computing. And some of you actually may remember, you know, it was just a little bit more than 2 years ago that we first talked to you about Zen and our ambitions there. And so much has really happened in the last 2 years. So let me start off with a little bit about AMD. I think you know us. I think you know us well. But one of the things that has been most important to me is to talk about our journey as a company. I've been CEO for 4 years, and it's been an incredible 4 years, but we are still at the beginning of that journey. And when we started out, we had sort of four key tenets. Okay, we are all about high performance. That's AMD at our best. We're about high performance technologies. And if you talk to anybody in today's AMD, everyone understands our value to the industry, our value to the market, is about putting out great products. And these are products that truly attack what are the next generations of things that are going on in the industry, what are the next generation of use cases. The idea is to be incredibly ambitious, but also recognize that it's a journey, and we will get there with the right determination. So, a little bit about our strategy. Our strategy hasn't changed. Our strategy is very, very clear. We have a focus on our two great pieces of technology and IP. It's about high performance graphics, and it's about high performance computing. And it's about how we put those two pieces together and truly come up with solutions that are unique and differentiating for our customers. And it's all about how do we add value to the ecosystem through partnerships, through customer relationships, and through platforms. And so when you think about all that, there's a lot to do. And now, you know, some of you know us for our consumer markets. We love all of our consumer markets. We love gaming. We actually love the PC market. There's a lot of innovation going on there. But today, our focus is going to be on the data center. It's about the incredible things that are happening in the data center, and it's about how AMD truly helps to shape that data center. Now, I think we all know the data center is just has enormous potential. And it's enormous potential, the way I like to say it, you know, the reason I came into semiconductors is because, frankly, I like solving problems. Our goal is to solve some of the world's toughest problems. And to do that, you need high-performance CPUs, and you need high-performance GPUs. And when you put that together, whether you're talking about, you know, modeling climate change, or you're talking about mapping the human genome, or you're talking about solving, you know, finding the cure for cancer, or some of the massive simulations that are done for oil and gas, all of that stuff requires incredible computing horsepower. And frankly, that's what we're great at. So now, what's really interesting is that the data center is truly evolving. And as we get more and more devices connected, you know, each of us has dozens of devices, and they're connected with lots and lots of data, and we need to figure out what to do with all that data. And the truth is, the workloads that are driving computing are changing extraordinarily dramatically. And whether you're talking about machine learning, or artificial intelligence, or what we're doing in the cloud environments, or virtualization environments, or you're talking about high-performance computing, there's just an incredible need for more computing horsepower. And the workloads are different. They're different than the workloads of 10 years ago. And as a result, the computing has to be different. So, why are we so excited? What's the prize? The prize is, you know, the data center represents an incredible opportunity. It's an incredible opportunity for us as technologists. It's an incredible opportunity for our partners. And when you look at it, you know, we see it as, let's call it a $20 billion market today, you know, 2021, going to a $29 billion market by the time we get to 2021. And if you look at the pieces of it, you know, the CPU market has always been critical in the foundation of the data center, and it's continuing to be critical, whether you're talking about the cloud environment or the enterprise environment. But the GPU, or the accelerator environment, is growing dramatically. really dramatically. And we see that as a growing piece of the TAM. And so if you look overall, we see strong double-digit growth as we go over the foreseeable future. Now, let me talk about our approach. Our approach at AMD is different, okay? We have been very, very deliberate on how we think about the data set. We are not looking at incremental changes. We're looking at ways to really dramatically change the game. And we've been focused on what's new, what's different, what's changing the data center. I told you before that the workloads are changing. There's a tremendous amount of migration into the cloud. However, there's also an incredible amount of work that you need to do on-prem. And with that, you have various different workloads that frankly do require some level of specialization and some level of sort of optimizing for what you're trying to do. And so when we look at the markets broadly, you know, we set out on a roadmap that is part of that journey, and we made some very important bets. You know, the technology industry, what I like to tell people is that the decisions that you're seeing today, the products that you're seeing today, are the products of decisions that we made 4 or 5 years ago. They were bets. They were bets on where the market is going. They were bets on where the technology is going. And decisions that we're making today are going to influence us 5 years from now. And so it's all about where do we think the market is going? How do we design our building blocks, our CPUs and our GPUs? How do we connect in the system? How do we bring our customers more performance and more capability? And how do we make sure that we have aggressive long-term roadmaps? Those are the ways that we think about being important in the data center. So it's been about 15 months or so, and many of you were with us when we first launched EPYC in June of 2017. And it's really been an incredible 15 months. You know, it was our first Zen-based server processor. It was our re-entry into the data center, or a new product that started this new way of thinking. And frankly, we're extremely pleased with how customers have adopted EPYC. You're gonna hear some from me today, you're gonna hear from some of our customers today. But what we give customers is the idea that you can optimize, you can have more performance at every price point. You can have more flexibility, taking however many cores you need, with however many memory channels you need, with however much I/O you need, and you can choose the right configuration for that particular application. And I have to say, I think we have shown the value. And the value, the most important thing for the data center, frankly, is the total cost of ownership. It is not just one thing, it's how all of those things come together. And so, like I said, very pleased with the first generation of EPYC. We also introduced in 2017 MI25. This was our first MI accelerator, Radeon Instinct, and frankly, we were focused again on those compute and cloud workloads. Bringing a product to market that really thinks about what do you need in the cloud? What do you need when you're trying to virtualize a machine? What do you need when you're running, you know, cloud gaming applications? What do you need for machine learning? And how do you create that ecosystem? That's the way we've been thinking about our GPU roadmap. And then, very, very importantly, is the ecosystem beyond the hardware. And you're gonna hear us talk a lot about this. The software ecosystem is critical, okay? Our philosophy is open source. Open source platform enables the largest ecosystem, it enables everyone to contribute, and it frankly encourages tremendous innovation. And to do that, you know, there's a lot of, let's call it the guts, of ensuring that we have the right libraries, the right app layers, and all that stuff. But at the end of the day, our goal is to bring a true alternative in the GPU compute space. So, let me talk a little bit about momentum. Now, momentum is so, so important. And you know, my conversation has always been, what are we doing for the customers? What are we doing for the ecosystem? How does AMD move the industry forward? So we've had a great first 15 months. I think you would look across the ecosystem partners. We have every major OEM and ODM with EPYC platforms in a big way. We have numerous system integrators and partners, and all of them are supporting our CPU or our GPU platforms and making them available to the customers more broadly. And then, of course, we have also been extremely focused on the cloud. The cloud is the largest growth driver of the data center. It's where tremendous innovation is happening. And we've been very, very honored to partner with a number of the top cloud customers. On the CPU side, you know, you see Microsoft, Baidu, Tencent, Oracle, Dropbox, and others with their cloud instances utilizing EPYC, making them available to a large number of users. On the GPU side, we also have some initial instances with Alibaba and Baidu and AWS. And we really see that there's tremendous growth opportunity for us in the cloud, and we are extremely thankful for the support of our partners here. So, momentum is clearly there. Now, today though, you guys came here to hear about new momentum and what we're doing moving forward. And it's been a very exciting day for us. We're gonna talk a lot about technology. We have a few demos for you. But I wanted to start the morning with actually a major new announcement around momentum and around ecosystem and around partnerships. So our goal with EPYC is to reach the largest number of users possible. And as I said, the cloud is the tip of that spear. And to do that, we must be partnered with the number one cloud service provider in the world. And so today, I'm extremely excited to announce for the very first time a partnership between AMD and Amazon Web Services on our EPYC CPU technology. And to talk more about this, let me invite Matt Gorman to the stage. Matt? And you know, why don't we just start first with, you know, you were one of the first guys at AWS. Tell us about their strategy and what AWS stands for.
Yeah, thank you, and thank you for having me here today. So you know, it's been an incredible ride with AWS, and a lot of what we think when we build the business and the products for our customers is it starts with our team. And the team, we hire builders. We want people that want to build things for our customers. And some of what allows them to do that is we take a long-term view how we go build the business and our partnerships and for our customers. We don't optimize quarter to quarter, we really have this long-term view. Take those two together, and then it really comes down to listening to our customers. When we think about products that we go deliver externally for our customers, 90% of those either come directly from customers or things they've asked for, or problems that they're asking us to solve. And that's really kind of how we focus and really keep a focus on what we want to go deliver.
No, I absolutely get that, and I think that focus is incredible. So when we look at, you know, how AMD fits into the picture and where you're thinking.
Yeah, so we think about our compute platforms. There's a couple of things that are important for our customers. The very first thing is security, reliability, and performance. And AMD is great on all of those fronts. The second thing that many of our customers come to AWS for is choice. When we think about our compute platforms, it really is about choice. We want to be the compute platform for the world. We want to support every single workload that's out there. For that, our customers need a broad range of capabilities, and AMD is what we're hearing from our customers. The EPYC platform is one of the things they're interested in, so we're really excited to be able to present that to them. And then the final thing is, frankly, cost. I talked to a lot of customers, and never have I talked to a customer who wasn't interested in lower prices.
I feel the same way.
Yeah, so I think that is pretty universally true, and AMD is helping us deliver lower prices.
Fantastic. So Matt, let's tell the audience what it is we have in store for them.
Yeah, so today we're really excited to announce AMD's EPYC processors as a part of three of our core AWS product lines. These are three of our most popular instances, and these are available today. We have the R5A, the M5A, and then the T3A, which will be coming in a couple of weeks. And these are some of our very most popular instance types that deliver on those three pillars that we talked about: security, choice, and low cost.
And Matt, I think you said they're available today. So tell us how customers really go out and Yeah. Get access to these instances.
Yeah, so one of the cool things about the cloud is that you can actually go and get them today. And so for the M5A and the R5A instances, those are available right now. In fact, I believe our team is launching them, so you guys can go out and actually start launching those today. And it's really easy. It's a simple API call to launch an instance. You can use the exact same images you use today, use the exact same scripts. All you do is change your M5 to an M5A, and you're up and running. And one of the great things here is for our customers, by simply making that change and switching, they can instantly save 10% on their compute costs. So we're really excited about what customers are going to be able to do, and we're expecting to see customers start using them right now.
That's fantastic. And from a software standpoint, you know, for customers, is it, you know, how hard is it?
Yep. So it's there really is no change at all to those. And we think about, if you think about the various applications that we have on our R5 instances, those are our big memory platforms. And many customers are running large databases there. You mentioned big data workloads and things earlier. It's a big, big area of focus for AMD. Many of our customers use that platform for that, and all they need to do is simply use the exact same software and relaunch on that. Our M5A instances, those are many of our line of business applications, also some databases and some data processing and Hadoop workloads. And our T instances are very popular for customers using like code repositories, blogging sites, many of our test and dev workloads, our burstable instances. And for all these instances, you can use the exact same images, the exact same scripts, simply change that one little parameter, and you can go and test them.
Just a little aid, guys. That's what
it
is. So, Matt, I want to say on behalf of AMD, your engineering team is amazing. We've had just a tremendous experience working with you. And, you know, we view this, you know, the fact that you're the number one guy out there as, you know, a real honor to be part of that ecosystem. So thanks a lot, and we look forward to doing a lot more together.
Awesome.
I mean, to have AWS now part of the AMD EPYC ecosystem and to have that out there for customers, it is truly our honor, and it is an example of what we're doing to really broaden EPYC in the industry today. Now, I also said that we have a tremendous amount of technology news for you, and we really do when we talk about the next horizon. And so what I thought I would do is just give you a little bit of an outline of what you're going to see from my team today. So as we start this next important chapter in the data center world, you're going to hear first from Mark Papermaster. You guys know Mark. You know him very, very well. He is the heart and soul of our technology team, of our roadmap, and our vision and strategy. And today, Mark is going to tell you about the early pieces of Zen 2. Zen 2 is our next generation CPU architecture. He and his team have put together just a remarkable engineering feat. And what you're going to see is what we're doing not only in the CPU, but what we're doing in the system design, which is truly, truly innovative, and how we bet big on 7-nanometer technology. And frankly, it's paying off for us. You're also going to hear from David Wang. Some of you may not know David. David actually joined AMD in February of this year. And he runs all things graphics and engineering. And David is going to talk about how we really design GPUs for the cloud. You know, how we think about where the cloud is going, how we think about how we put together the high-performance compute engines, how we think about the machine learning operations, how we think about the interconnections, and where we're going over the next few years. And David will also reveal the initial specifications for our AMD Radeon Instinct MI60. We are extremely excited to be the first 7-nanometer GPU in the industry, and we decided that data center was the place that we were going to deploy this technology. And so you're going to see tremendous performance from MI60, and you're going to see how we use it in cloud applications. So with that, we go to the last piece, where we'll also hear from Forrest Norton. Forrest runs our data center business. Forrest knows exactly what customers need because he was a customer himself. And he'll be talking about all of the progress that we've made with our first generation EPYC and key workloads. Because it's all about the workload. It's all about the workload. It's all about how we do things better in the ecosystem. But then we'll also give you the first preview of ROM. And I said preview, so we'll give you some of the specifications. But most importantly, we'll share with you our vision for where Rome fits in the industry. Why we believe Rome as the first 7-nanometer data center CPU in the industry has some incredible capabilities, and what we'll be able to do with that. So your takeaway, hopefully, from the day will be AMD's total commitment to the data center. And I mean total commitment. We love innovation, we love solving hard problems, we love putting new technology out there, but at the end of the day, it is about what we can do for our customer and what we can do to solve some of those world's toughest problems. So with that, let me bring out Mark Papermaster to go through the technology.
It's a great pleasure to be here today. I'm really excited because I love technology. Our teams, our engineering teams, love technology. This is our passion. And we've got some very exciting disclosures to make in terms of how we have applied technology, how we brought both the semiconductor technology, the design elements together. And that's really what it's about in our field of high performance computing in a post-Moore's Law era. It is not about any one vector that you can bring to bear to drive that performance forward generation after generation. It's about bringing all of the features together, a holistic design approach, and that's what we live and breathe at AMD. So what I'd like to do is just share you with you the progress on our technology and our CPU journey. And you think about the CPU journey, for AMD there was a new phase that we kicked off back in 2012. That's where we started the design of Zen, a new high performance from scratch x86 processor. And we set it out in motion leveraging the 14 nanometer FinFET, so it was a big jump for us to be able to get that scalability of the FinFET transistor. And at the same time when we launched that Zen design, we launched the Infinity Fabric. Because we looked at where those post-Moore's Law trends were going, and we knew we needed flexibility about how we could put our investments in new high-performance IP, both CPU and GPU, together in our roadmap going forward. So it was here in San Francisco 2 years ago that we first pulled the veil back on Zen. We revealed it had a 52% instruction per clock, IPC improvement over the previous generation. And it was a momentous day for us because it showed that when we put our focus, brought our engineers on that point for high performance, that we would deliver. And that's what we've done. In fact, at that time, I committed to a strong roadmap. I committed to that we would have what we call leapfrogging design teams so that we would be able to keep ourselves in high performance going forward, right? That we would never be providing any type of gap for our customers, that we have a continuous flow in our development process. And that's why today is so important for us, because Zen 2 marks the delivery of that promise, that continuity, as well as for the rest of our roadmap moving forward, where we have strong momentum. So let me share that with you. So again, we launched in early 2017 our Zen-based product. We followed that with a kicker for our client roadmap in 12 nanometer, and that provided a very nice bump on top of the base Zen that we had across our client products. And then today, I'll give you an update on Zen 2. What has 7 nanometer brought for us? What did we do from the design element? We'll spend a little time and go through that, and we are sampling today. So we are delivering that as samples and on track to deliver Zen 2 to market in 2019. And Zen 3, our next generation, also on track. Again, leapfrogging design teams. One team's done, it's flipping over working on the generation next. So there's always two full design efforts in flight at AMD. You've got commitment, continuity. And that's a significant point I want to underscore for you with AMD. We call the play, we call the roadmap. We've been stable, we've been executing, we are delivering to that that play that we called. And look, we're positioned now is to bring leadership for the most demanding workloads, existing traditional workloads and the emerging workloads, is what we are delivering with this roadmap. So focus, execution, and delivery. And that's what makes AMD a bankable supplier. And when we made the effort to go back into high performance, equally important with coming out with that first set of products we launched in 2017 was the roadmap behind it, because that's what the enterprise customers need. They want to know that you're delivering value today, and they need full confidence in the roadmap going forward. That's what we're doing. That's a game changer for AMD in driving the acceptance of these new high-performance products in the market. You know, I'd like to just look back just a little bit on that acceptance of the market. So again, you know, there it was early 2017 when we launched Ryzen, and it really shook up high performance. When you deliver that kind of performance, generation of performance gains, and you unleash the reins on how you deliver it, bringing more cores, more I/O, more memory to high performance desktop, it really lifted the roof. And you saw the extensibility when we brought out Threadripper, and more recently, Threadripper 2, bringing a leadership, 32 cores to high performance desktop. So we drove a whole set of change with Ryzen. We followed mid last year with Epic, and you'll hear a lot more from Forrest about our acceptance as we come back into the data centers. And then of course, that scalability that I described even from the outset with the Zen core, being able to take that base design, leverage the investments that we made in what I call our hidden gem, that infinity fabric, that modularity that it gives to our design, to be able to scale that processor from those highest performance applications right into the mobile space. And we launched Ryzen Mobile at the end of last year, and it's got a very wide acceptance across notebook platforms and is growing significant share. In fact, Ryzen has been awarded 700 recognitions over the time since its inception. So a very broad acceptance of the Ryzen product family. And of course, again, in Epic, we're getting excellent acceptance in the market. And so this is a phenomenal time as we look at that transition, moving from that acceptance of Zen, getting AMD back in high performance, and now with Zen 2, setting the mark of what we're about at AMD when we said we're committed to driving strong roadmap and generational improvement. And so that's what I'd like to do, is start with one of the key elements of Zen 2, and that's 7-nanometer process. So I said Moore's Law is slowing down. We call it, of course, Moore's Law Era, Moore's Law Plus, whatever name you'd like to give it. But I'll tell you, it doesn't mean that semiconductor nodes don't matter. What it means is they are more expensive. We're not getting the frequency lift that we used to get over each generation. But picking the right technology and executing on the right foundry technology is phenomenally important. And we made a huge bet. We looked at the success that we had with FinFET on Zen and how we had leveraged that scalability. And we looked at 10-nanometer, the next node, it was a half node, and we determined that for what our customers needed, that wasn't the right jump. We were going to lean in and jump to 7-nanometer, the next full node, which we felt would be a long and sustained node in the industry. And we took that leap, we focused, and we executed. I'd like to just describe a little bit about what that meant. Well, first off, we had to recognize it was a tough lift. 7-nanometer adds significant masking levels. The resistances go up, what we call the parasitics, all of the physics around the transistor that you have to battle to achieve your power and your performance, all made it a tougher challenge in 7-nanometer. And we took that on because the benefit of the lower power and the shrink, the density, we could get, if we pulled this off of 7-nanometer, we felt would be disruptive in the industry. And so we went into a deep partnership with TSMC, which is the lead 7-nanometer fab in the industry. We went into a deep partnership with our EDA, the computer-aided design partners we have in the industry. Why? Because with all the physics I described to you, it can't be done by just a design team. It can't be done just by the fab. It takes a three-way partnership because you need advanced software to handle those designs, those very, very tight constraints of that newest generation node. And that partnership really paid off. We started it well in advance before the design effort even started. And it's resulted in an excellent start for us, an excellent yield. And TSMC is doing well with this process. In fact, we already have several designs back and doing extremely well in our labs. And our first 7-nanometer product, which is our GPU, 7-nanometer Vega, on track to ship later this year. So, you know, why was this such a big deal? Well, you just have to ask our customers. We're in the business of high performance. When you're in the business of high performance, it's all about what performance can you give me in the computer socket that I have. There's not a lot of flexibility generation to generation. You want to maximize the value for a constraint that you have on the power, the footprint that you have in that computer. And when 7-nanometer brought an astounding doubling of density at half the power, that's game-changing type of opportunity. So you could have taken that at, you know, just shrinking the die size and lowering the power, and so you could make that, you know, a play that says, let me just make a denser application of what we have, you know, with our first generation. But that's not what we did. It's not what our customers wanted. They wanted us to maximize that performance for the socket anywhere that we put Zen. And that's what we've done, and that's where 7-nanometer delivers tremendous value to our end customers. In fact, it's historic. It's absolutely historic. Our competitor, our x86 CPU competitor, has had a commanding lead in process technology. And in fact, when we made that seven nanometer decision, we felt we'd be on a path to come close. We felt that in fact it would be historic, and that we could potentially achieve almost a parity at about the same time. But what has happened is its leadership. 7-nanometer is the first of this set of dimensions. The 7-nanometer is roughly equivalent, you know, the same zone as the dimensions, the critical dimensions, with our competitors, 10-nanometer. And in fact, it's first to market. And so this is really a phenomenal achievement in the industry. It's a statement of where foundry technology is, and it's a statement of the execution of lead foundry. It's a statement of execution by our partner, TSMC. In fact, let's hear from YJ Me. YJ is a senior vice president of R&D and technology at TSMC.
TSMC's 7-nanometer technology is leading the industry in performance, power, area density, and schedule. We're excited that the industry's most leading-edge logic process technology, TSMC's N7, is available for customers to use. This marks the first time in semiconductor industry that the most advanced logic technology is available for all product innovations at the same time. We are already in volume production of N7 since second quarter of this year. AMD and TSMC have a very strong 15 plus years relationships based on our mutual dedication to delivering products and technologies that reshape industries. We have been working closely with AMD on its next generation high performance 7-nanometer based products. We have worked well with the design group. Together, we address AMD's end market performance. We look forward to continue our close working relationships on AMD's future products to bring the benefits of leading edge logic process technology and high performance designs to market.
It has been a 15-year partnership, and that was a true key element of our ability to partner as deeply as we did, to take head-on the challenges with 7-nanometer, and to be positioned to deliver our first products this year. So let's go further. Let's now take that process, that semiconductor process element of Zen 2, and look what happens when you marry that across the design elements. And what you see is that it is that holistic design that I talked about. So you take the world's first high-performance 7-nanometer class node and apply it to x86, and you pair it with CPU core enhancements. Again, you have to hit every element of the design process. And so we did that. We also paired it, again, with our modular design approach, that Infinity Fabric, in fact, the second generation of the Infinity Fabric. And of course, we added yet more security elements, which is really an ongoing process for all of us in the microprocessor industry. So those are all of the elements that came together to deliver performance. We're talking a huge performance improvement when you bring those facets together. It's a 2x in the throughput, the computing throughput per node that you can achieve, per compute node. And you know, you won't be surprised when I walk you through this, because again, how you deliver performance in microprocessors is well known. It is about attacking all of the elements it takes to have a balanced computer. So everything you do is about adding more performance, more capability, but being able to feed all of the engines so you don't have stalls, so that you achieve real performance gain in the end applications that you're running. And that's what we've done with Zen 2. And you know, it's across the execution pipelines and how you feed it. It's across the floating point, where we've doubled the floating point capability, including the load store, the pass in which we feed it, the core density, leveraging 7-nanometer core density, and of course, leveraging all of the energy efficiencies of 7-nanometer. So what I'd like to do is walk through each of these and just share with you the delivery, some of the elements that came in to deliver that kind of throughput capability on Zen 2. And it starts with the front end. We improved our branch prediction capabilities. And really, not just the branch prediction itself, but also how you can prefetch from the inspection side. We went beyond that. And so it's about feeding the pipeline, avoiding stalls. So branch prediction, prefetch, and then the micro-op cache, right? So you have those instructions, there you go. And then actually increasing the size of that micro-op cache. As you recall, I shared with you that we introduced that in Zen. And so what you see here is pulling the levers to improve that full front end to ensure that we, as we go to Zen 2 and we up the processing capability, that we've also upped our efficiency in feeding the execution pipelines. The next that I will certainly talk about is that floating point that I described. This is really a huge deal for us. And when you look at Zen, we've had a great reception of our floating point in high performance compute applications. Because what we did was we made a decision in Zen. We started with a 128-bit data path. What we wanted to do was make the most efficient 128-bit data path out there, because that's where the software at the time, and really still to this day, that's where most of the software applications are written to take advantage of. And it's actually gotten excellent success. So you look at the applications out there that can really leverage vector computing and floating point, like fluid flow analysis, like molecular dynamics, like ray tracing on a CPU for rendering. These do extremely well on our Zen platforms. But we looked at what we could do in 7-nanometer. What could we do with the kind of capability of doubling the density at half the power? And the decision was obvious here. Let's grow on that success that we had with floating point in Zen. Let's bring that capability up. Let's double that effort. So what does that mean if you want to keep a balanced computer? What that means is that you, of course, double the vector width. So we went to 256-bit on the vector width, but we doubled how we feed it. So we doubled the load store, we doubled the pathway, the data pathway into the 256-bit. And so we ensured that you could, you know, really reap the benefits in, again, real-world workloads of this doubled floating point. The other thing that we did was we increased the dispatch and retire bandwidth so that even non-vectorized workloads would be much more efficient running on Zen 2's floating point. So it's really a significant investment. We're delivering tremendous value. HPC workloads in our Zen products today, and what you will see is a huge jump as we go to Zen 2 based products. Very, very exciting. So I talked about security, and as you know from us at AMD, security is always a top priority. We've delivered a leading edge memory encryption capability on our Zen based product. And the way that we did that is it's really an inline encryption. So the performance overhead is very low, it's on the order of a percent or two, to be able to encrypt data as it goes out to memory. So any of that data standing at rest on memory when you deploy this feature in AMD is fully encrypted with protected keys within our security unit. And what we've done as we've gone forward in Zen 2 is where you have virtualized applications, highly virtualized applications, or multi-tenant cloud, we've increased the number of keys significantly. So we had a very good reception to this feature in our Zen-based Epic application. And the request from the customers is, I like that. Let me support more partitions, more VMs that might need unique encryption keys. And that's exactly what we've done on Zen 2. The other thing that we've done, of course, is this continual focus on any potential attack on our processor. If you look at Frost 2018, it was a year that there was a tremendous focus on side channel attacks. We were also very, very focused at AMD on mitigations for side channel attacks. Meltdown and Foreshadow did not affect AMD because of our microarchitecture, so you could not have that exposure on the AMD architecture, microarchitecture. But of course, Spectre, we did. And we apply very, very strong software and microcode mitigations for all of our products across on Spectre. So what have we done on Zen 2? We've hardened those. So that was what we've taken, a number of the approaches that we took in microcode and software, and we've hardened those in our Zen 2 security, or Zen 2 implementation. So a very strong security that we've had at AMD gets stronger yet again on Zen 2. And of course, this is an area that AMD stays completely focused to address any new threat attacks that may come as time progresses. A consistent, full focus on security within our company. Next, I want to talk about our approach, that leveraging that I described of that hidden gem, our Infinity Fabric. And it's really proven so beneficial. You saw that first implementation on Epic. You saw how we took a multi-chip approach, four die that we connected chip to chip, actually within the chip, then chip to chip, and even socket to socket, leveraging that Infinity Fabric to bring modularity and to bring scalability. And really, it allowed us to pull off what we did because it's almost unimaginable to how we could have brought 32 cores per socket without this approach. In fact, the cost would have been 1.7x higher had we done a monolithic approach, had we made one big die versus the multi-chip approach that we did for Epic, the cost would have been 1.7x higher. So we clearly showed the advantage of this type of partitioning that you can do to bring more cores per socket and configurability. And you've seen us leverage that configurability. How can a company our size take the kind of technology we have and run it from high-performance desktops to the server, to world-class supercomputer applications, and then right back down into the mobile space? That's the configurability that we built in to our design approach. So what I'm excited to share with you is what we've done with our second generation Infinity Fabric. What we've done is opened it up even further. Higher performance and more scalability. In fact, what we do is really leverage, how do we get the best out of that 7 meter technology? How do we leverage Infinity Fabric to actually separate out and use 7 nanometer where it gives us the maximum advantage? Our CPU cores, where every bit of density and density of compute, which means performance per watt that you can shrink in the smallest space, that's what 7 nanometer delivers. And so what we did was pulled out those core execution blocks into a set of chiplets that we connect back into a 14 nanometer die that controls all of our I/O, our memory, you know, our front side bus, you know, that's all on the 14 nanometer die. So what does that give us? Optimization. The I/Os that we had didn't scale well. That's a part of the physics. If you study this, you'll see that the big interface circuitry don't scale as well, like the digital circuitry you need for performance within a CPU. The analog circuits don't scale as well. So it was just fine to keep them on 14 nanometer and to optimize that set of the interface functionality on 14 nanometer and then break into a set of chiplets that's 7 nanometer high performance. So better latency and optimization for those analog circuitry on that set of I/O die, and then optimized performance on CPU fed to each other and back to through the I/O die to the second generation Infinity Fabric. So very, very exciting what we've been able to achieve. And what you see is really a revolutionary new approach. We have taken multi-chip to a revolutionary chiplet design approach, and I think you will find others in the industry adopting this in more and more ways, because this is the best way to keep the performance pace of Moore's Law going forward. It will be a heterogeneous world. You'll need chiplets that you can very efficiently bring together and in this type of approach to stay on a Moore's Law performance pace, even when those big nodes are becoming a little bit more costly and becoming further in between. So we're super excited to be rolling out this new chiplet approach for Zen 2. So let's talk a little bit about that performance. I said it was holistic. And so when you put it all together, what I walked you through, the process technology allowing us to double our throughput at the same power, the design elements that I walk you through that allow us to increase our structure per clock and increase our throughput. And we drove, as I said just a moment ago, a revolutionary chiplet approach to maximize the benefit of the technology to deliver true performance value and very high manufacturability. When you bring those 7 nanometer chips down into a small chiplet, you make them much easier to manufacture, and that is a key element, is what allowing us to push very, very aggressively in an aggressive early fashion in 7 nanometer. So, you know, really, we seized the opportunity to Zen 2. We seized the opportunity to leverage process technology and design and to leverage that modularity, that configurability we have to keep us on pace, to satisfy that insatiable demand in the industry for more and more compute per socket, and compute that can be delivered securely. That is what Zen 2 is about. It's about delivering performance that matters, real world performance to our end customers. And what I'm incredibly excited is about the momentum, because it was our commitment, to our customers that we would deliver to the roadmap that we set out, that we would not accept the slowing of Moore's Law, that we would bring innovation. Innovation is what AMD is known about. That's our history. We didn't lose it. We brought that innovation to a new level, but we brought it with an incredible focused execution. So we delivered on what we promised. We kept the momentum going with Zen 2. We are right on track to bring 7 nanometer based CPUs to market, and we are committed to the future. Zen 4 design is in its design completion phase. It's right on track. And so this is what the AMD team is about. We have worked incredibly hard to bring AMD back to higher performance. We will not let up, and momentum is now on our side. Thank you very much. Okay, with that, it gives me an incredible pleasure to present the next speaker, which is David Lang. David is our senior VP of our RTG engineering team, and it's been just so great to have David come back to AMD, and I think you'll be really excited with what you hear. So with that, let me introduce David. Thank you.
everybody. I'm so excited to be here to share with you the tremendous opportunities of AMD GPU in data center. I've been with the AMD, we joined AMD for almost a year now, and I'm very impressed by what the team has developed. You heard from Mark that 7 nanometers is great, and the Zen 2 core in 7 nanometers is fantastic. And today, I'll discuss with you what the team, the GPU team, has developed in 7 nanometers, the data center GPU. So let's first talk about where we're coming from. The AMD Radeon brand has been best known for consumer gaming and for professional workstation applications. Indeed, we have an installed base of more than 400 million of PCs, workstations, and game consoles combined. 400 million. We believe this gaming and professional workloads are moving to the cloud because of the promise allowing the hundreds of millions of gamers, the developers, to be able to run their content from anywhere, at any time, on any devices. It enables a truly new type of distribution model that's flexible, that's always available, and it's low cost per user. And people will never have to worry about their GPU hardware or their GPU software get outdated again. With our experience in this application, and with our huge install base, the AMD Radeon is best positioned to go into the data center to support the current workload as well as the emerging workload. So, what are the workloads for the data center GPU? We talk about gaming, the cloud gaming. We talk about professional applications. We call them virtual desktop and virtual workstations. For those applications to be successful running in the cloud, the key is for the cloud service providers to reduce the cost per user. And that's why virtualization is important. It allows multiple users to share the use of a single GPU. And obviously, in that case, security is also very important because you don't want one user to interfere with another. And of course, GPU is great for the emerging workloads like machine learning and high-performance computing, because GPU offers massive amount of computation power. For machine learning also, it can benefit from the flexibility of GPU architecture, because machine learning workload, the algorithms are still evolving and still changing. For HPC, besides high performance, it also demands extremely high accuracy. And that's why 64-bit floating point operation is important. We have estimated a total TAM for the GPU in data center to reach $12 billion by 2021. So you can see, this is a huge opportunity for GPU and a huge opportunity for AMD. So today, we are excited to announce the AMD Radeon Instinct MI60 product that's designed, optimized for data center, for the cloud. It's real, it's here, and let's show it. Thank you. Okay, so this is your world's first 7 nanometer GPU. Again, the world's first 7 nanometer GPU. 7 nanometer, Mark has already talked about. Performance, power, density. And this is the GPU, the MI60. It also based on an enhanced Vega architecture that has high performance and improves the flexibility. It also provides leading edge memory and connectivity. And we'll talk about it's the world's only GPU supports power-based virtualization. Those are all important things to accelerate workloads in the cloud. Okay, so why does 7 nanometer matter? It's high density. With high density, we can put more functionalities. We can put more performance on the die, but yet still shrink the die size to improve the cost. As you can tell, the MI60 die size is a lot smaller than MI25, even though the performance is a lot higher, with much more functionality, which we'll go through. And also, because the 7 nanometer, it delivers higher performance and lower power. That greatly improves the performance per watt, which is a game changer for cloud service providers, because it allows them in the fixed power envelope to improve the performance greatly, or allow them to reduce the energy bill. That's a great deal for the cloud service providers. And MI60 is based on the enhanced Vega architecture. It's high performance, it's flexible. It's world's fastest 64-bit and 32-bit floating-point processor based on PCIe, the standard PCIe configuration. And it has included special machine learning operations to accelerate training and inference workload. The architecture is flexible, that yes, a configurable mathematical pipeline can support from the 64-bit floating point all the way down to 4-bit and 1-bit integer operation. So that allows us to support wide range and optimize performance for wide range of workload. And this is not a consumer class gaming GPU. It's designed for enterprise. It contains ECC, the error checking and correction, inside the register, and memory inside the GPU. This is a great foundation of what we're building upon. And computation is not enough, because it needs data. And GPU is not for consuming, processing a lot of data. MI60 supports 32 gigabytes of HBM2 memory. And it's the first GPU, again, the first GPU to achieve 1 terabyte per second of bandwidth. And another thing happened. It allowed the GPU to move data much faster at a lower energy consumption, so that improves performance into the power. And it also includes the ECC. So it's not only data protection within the GPU, but also data protection outside of the GPU. So this end-to-end ECC protection really provides MI60, the enterprise class of reliability. And of course, with such a large frame buffer memory, it supports large data sets that are required for machine learning and HPC applications. So now let's talk about connectivity. Why does connectivity matter? The performance is not only the single GPU performance, it's the system performance. It's how the GPU talks to the CPU. And it's how GPU talk to other GPUs in a multi-GPU system. Again, MI60 is world's first GPU supporting PCIe Gen 4, and that is double bandwidth compared to previous generation. And MI60 is the first GPU we're taking advantage of the Infinity Fabric that Mark talked about earlier as a high-speed interconnect between GPUs. So you can see from the construction here that a 1 EPYC CPU can connect without bridges, to 4 GPUs through the high-bandwidth PCIe Gen 4 interconnect. That really, really speed up the data transfer from the CPU to the GPU and vice versa. You can also see with the Infinity Fabric, the 4 GPUs are now connected in the ring, and that really helps scaling the multi-GPU operation and performance. Power-based virtualization is the key differentiation for the AMD GPU. Because it's done in hardware, it simplifies, makes the deployment of the application to the cloud without software overhead. It also provides power-based data isolation, so that improves the security, making sure when multiple users are sharing one GPU, they don't interfere with each other in a hardware way. It supports a flexible use model of have one GPU serving multiple users, like virtual desktop, virtual workstation type of application. But it also allows the system to scale to accelerate large workload with multiple GPUs. So this is really our differentiation. And what's even better is that it is free. We don't charge license fee for virtualization. It comes with the GPU, comes with the hardware and software. The customers love it. Okay, so great hardware means great software. Let's talk about machine learning, which is the fastest growing workload for GPU and data center. About 3 years ago, AMD started the journey of building an open source machine learning framework called ROCm. We believe in open source because it drives innovation, because it enables community participation. Indeed, our customers, our partners love ROCm. Love open source idea. Why? Because our customers want differentiation. They want to develop working with us, but add their differentiation instead of being constrained by a fixed, by a closed system. You can see from the diagram here, the ROCm supports runtime, supports multiple programming languages, open source, support open source library, and also the machine learning frameworks. And what's even better is that ROCm runs some all different kinds of accelerators. You run some CPU, AMD CPU, AMD GPU, AMD APU, or any other kind of deep learning accelerators. If people want, they can even port ROCm on NVIDIA GPU and Intel CPU. Is that open? And today, I'm proud to announce the release of ROCm 2.0. It comes with the Vega, it comes with MI60. It supports the latest and greatest machine learning frameworks with optimized math and communication libraries. It also supports the popular Docker and Kubernetes content management software. Allow us to much easier moving the content, moving the application to the cloud in a scalable way. And last but not least, it has been upstream as part of a Linux kernel distribution. So what's the big deal? Well, it's really embraced by our open source community. Without upstream, the ROCm suddenly get access to millions and millions of users of Linux. You can see, this is a partial list of the open source communities, the frameworks, the compilers, the tools that we're working with. For example, we've been working with Google on TensorFlow optimization. We've been working with Facebook on PyTorch and Caffe2. We've been working with Baidu on PaddlePaddle. Everybody wants open source. And we are committed to open source. And the rock on open source community is horrible. Okay, now let's see what Google had to say about open source effort. Open source is good for everyone. And with Markdown's open software platform, TensorFlow users can benefit from the GPU acceleration and the more robust open source machine learning ecosystem. We are completely aligned with Google's open source strategy. Baidu. AMD has formed joint lab with Baidu. Together, we're developing machine learning applications and frameworks. So let's hear from Baidu on what they have to say about their collaboration with AMD.
Baidu is the world's largest Chinese search engine and a leading artificial intelligence company. As a leader in AI, Baidu well understands the value of high performance computing technologies. We choose AMD as a key partner on AI computing and we are working very closely in a joint line program with open source solutions from both parties, including Baidu Pentaho framework.